بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين، وعلى جميع إخوانه من النبيين والمرسلين وآل كل وصحب كل ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to facilitate for us all the routes of success in this life and in the hereafter. Alhamdulillah, who enabled us to gather in the mosque where we put the intention of i'tikaf as long as we are in it. So we gain the rewards of i'tikaf as well, on top of intending to listen to the religious session for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We were talking in a series of lessons about the obligatory knowledge, and we stopped at the sins of the tongue. We spoke about few of the sins of the tongue, and tonight inshallah in our lesson we'll continue talking about the rest of the sins of the tongue. Al-Ghazali said, the tongue is a great endowment from Allah Azza wa Jal. Though small in size, but its crime is great. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned in the hadith that most of those who will be admitted into hellfire, they will be admitted into it due to committing crimes by their tongues. So this tongue is very small, but it could take you to hellfire. That's why you need to learn about the sins of the tongue so you can avoid them. We mentioned about gossip and talebearing amongst the sins of the tongue. Gossip is very widespread, unfortunately. It is to mention something about your Muslim brother or sister behind his or her back that they don't like to be mentioned with. Here we're talking about something true, such as to say about your Muslim brother or sister, he's short, she's short, or he's fat and the like. He doesn't like to be mentioned with such a thing. So if you talk about him in something pertaining to his physical attributes or to his lineage or to his manners and the like that he doesn't like to be mentioned with, this is called gossip. If you are fabricating thing about him, so you are lying in your talk about your Muslim brother or sister, this is called al-buhtan, fabrication, and this is more sinful. Because some people, when you tell them, if you hear them talking about a Muslim brother and you tell them, haram, don't talk about your Muslim brother, they reply quickly by saying, I'm not lying. Even if you are not lying, this is called the gossip. They don't like to be mentioned with it. If you are lying, fabricating lies about them, then this is al-buhtan, which is more sinful. However, tale-bearing is to convey to someone that another person said such and such about you. Then you go to that person and you tell him so and so said such and such about you to stir up troubles between them. This is called an-namima, the tale-bearing. instead of reconciling between those who have dispute amongst themselves, they stir up troubles by transmitting words between X and Y. This is called a namima, and that is haram as well. Gossip and tale-bearing and not protecting oneself from being contaminated with urine are the most sins that cause one to be tortured in his grave. These are three sins. Also amongst the sins of the tongue, as we mentioned, to stir up troubles amongst others, even without passing words. Sometimes a person may give a gesture with his hand to provoke a fight between two Muslims. They were arguing, then a third person will intervene instead of calming them down, telling them to fear Allah Azza wa Jal. He would tell them to fight each other, to punch each other. Sometimes even without saying any word, but he would give a gesture by his hand, like this for instance. That person will understand from it, punch him. And the like, that is haram. Even to goad animals to fight against one another is forbidden as well, as some people do between two dogs or two roosters or two rams and the like. That is even haram. Some people would bring two animals, like two rams, two roosters, and they get them to fight against each other and they bet on them and the like. That's haram as well. So even without betting, it's haram. Goading animals to fight one another is haram in Islam. Also to lie. To lie means to say what is opposite to the truth, while one knowing that what he's saying is against the truth. That is haram, even if one is serious or one is joking. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يصلح الكذب في جد ولا في هزل. Meaning lying is invalid whether one is joking or serious. And we warned you against what is called April Fool's Day, where some people think they are joking or mucking around and they tell lies to others and they cause a big harm to them because of this, unfortunately. Also amongst the sins of the tongue is to commit perjury, that is to swear to a lie. For one to swear by Allah Azza wa Jal or by one of the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal to something that is a lie, that is a major sin. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called such a swearing that a person is making al-yamin al-ghamus, that causes one to be submerged in hellfire on the day of judgment. So to lie, that's haram. To swear by Allah to a lie, that is more sinful, because he is swearing by the name of Allah Azza wa Jal. The swearing that is valid, if one were to make an oath, such as to say, I swear by Allah that I won't do such and such. Now, in order for such a swearing to be valid, the scholar said, it's the swearing that is done by swearing by Allah Azza wa Jal, any of the names of Allah or any of his attributes. Such as if one were to say, I swear by the power of Allah, I swear by Ar-Rahman. This is a valid swearing. But to swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such as to say, I swear by my parents, I swear by the Kaaba, for instance. What's the judgment? To swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Imam Shafi'i radiallahu anhu disliked it. However, Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu said, it is haram to swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the meaning of the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which means, so let one who is making a swearing make it by swearing by Allah azza wa jal only, or otherwise let him remain silent. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard one of the companions swearing by his father, and he did not deem him a blasphemer. He told him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow you to swear by your fathers. So if you were to make a swearing, swear by Allah azza wa jal or remain silent. He did not say to him, you're a mushrik or you're a kafir because you swore by other than Allah azza wa jal. No. None of the reliable scholars, none of them said that the one who swears by other than Allah is mushrik. Rather, they said the one who swears by other than Allah azza wa jal, either, as Imam al-Shafi'i said, it's disliked, very disliked, he disliked it, or what Imam Ahmad radiallahu anhu said, that it is haram. Unless one is swearing by other than Allah, glorifying that thing to the extent of glorifying Allah azza wa jal. So as if this person is giving that thing a status of godhood, a glorification the same as one would give glorification to Allah azza wa jal, then it would be blasphemous. But as many people these days do, they swear by their children. A person would say, I swear by my children, to show to the other person that how his children are valuable to him, he's swearing by them. That is, according to Imam Ahmad, haram, and according to Imam al-Shafi'i, disliked. Also amongst the sins of the tongue is to say any statement of qazf against another person. Al-qazf is to accuse someone of fornication or adultery or sodomy, or to attribute fornication or adultery, zina, to any of this person's relatives, such as his mother or his sister. Some people might not direct the swearing to that person by accusing him of fornication or adultery. Rather, they would call him son of an adulteress. So if he calls him, O son of an adulteress, he attributed his mother to adultery, and that is classified as qazf, and that's a major sin. Qazf can be explicit and implicit. Explicit is any statement that explicitly attributes one to fornication or adultery, such as to say to a person, you are a fornicator. That's explicit. You are an adulterer, for instance. That's explicit. However, the implicit statement is any statement that bears the meaning of accusing that person of fornication or adultery, and also it bears another meaning, such as to say to a Muslim, O Fajr, Fajr, he called him Fajr. O Fasiq, Fasiq means enormous sinner. O khabith, wicked. Now that statement can mean qazf and can mean something else. So if he had the intention of qazf, it will be classified as qazf in that case. Even with the implicit, when he intends to accuse that person of fornication or adultery, also, that will be classified as qazf, and that is a major sin as well. Other people might insinuate. They say words indirectly And this is called insinuating. They say such words. So he would say, Alhamdulillah, Ana ibn Halal. In Arabic, Alhamdulillah, I'm a legitimate son. Indirectly, he is insinuating that the other one is not. So when he uses such an expression, and he is insinuating that the other person is an illegitimate son, that is haram as well. But it's not like the explicit qazf that we mentioned. Also amongst the sins of the tongue is to swear at the companions. To swear at the companions. If one were to swear at all of them, then it is blasphemous. Because the companions are the ones who transmitted the religion to us. How did we get the Quran? From the companions. The companions to the followers to the followers of the followers, and so on until our time. So the one who swears at all the companions commits a blasphemy, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the companions, especially we're talking about the ones who embraced Islam at the beginning of the da'wah. Allah ta'ala said, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ. Those who embrace Islam at the beginning of the da'wah from the immigrants and the supporters in Medina. وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ. And those who followed their footsteps in righteousness. رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. Allah Ta'ala highly accepted them. So the one who swears at all the companions blasphemes, but the one who swears at some of those righteous companions commits a major sin, such as to swear at Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu or Umar, that is a major sin. Also amongst the sins of the tongue is to give false testimony as well. A person may give a false testimony relying on what? On his status, social status, and by this he takes the rights of others or make others lose their rights. Or he might use his power, he might use his money. So the one who gives a false testimony in this case and before the judge, that is an enormous sin. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَدَلَتْ شَهَادَةُ الزُّورِ الْإِشْرَاكَ بِاللَّهِ. Listen to this. عَدَلَتْ شَهَادَةُ الزُّورِ الْإِشْرَاكَ بِاللَّهِ. Literally, it means to give a false testimony is equivalent to associating partners with Allah. That's literally. But that's not the meaning of it. It means giving a false testimony is a major sin, close to blasphemy. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam draws an analogy between a sin and blasphemy, this is to show that this is a major sin. Same when he said about the one who does not pray, he said, Al-ahdu alladhi baynana wa baynahum as-salah, man tarakaha faqad kafar. The one who does not pray, literally it means is a blasphemer. The one who does not pray is a blasphemer. But is that the meaning of the hadith? No, it means he has committed a major sin close to blasphemy. But he is still Muslim. He is still Muslim. This is to show that this is a major sin. Same when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سِبَابُ الْمُسْلِمْ فُسُوق وَقِتَالُهُ كُفُرْ. To swear at a Muslim, that's a major sin. To fight him for worldly matters, that's kufr, the Prophet said. What does it mean, kufr? Meaning a major sin close to blasphemy. So when the Prophet likens a sin to blasphemy, this is to show the abhorrence of such a sin. How abhorrent this sin is. It's very abhorrent, very ugly, very enormous. That's the meaning of the hadith. Also amongst the sins of the tongue is to keep delaying paying one's debt when it is due while one is able to pay it back on time. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Layyul wajid yuhillu 'irdahu wa 'uqubatahu." Meaning the one who is able to pay the debt back on time, on due date, but he chooses to keep deferring for no excuse, such a sin makes it permissible for others to mention him with his habit and with his manners. So that's the meaning of yuhillu irdahu. People can talk about him that such a person does not pay on due date. He procrastinates, keeps deferring. He doesn't pay on time. So they can mention that about him. وَعُقُوبَتَهُ The ruler would punish him, put him in prison, hit him and the like, to force him to pay the debt back. Also amongst the sins of the tongue is for one to lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his messenger. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Inna kaziban alay laysa ka kazibin ala ahad. Faman kazaba alayya muta'ammidan falyatabawwa maq'adahu minan nar." Fabricating a lie about me, meaning, is not like fabricating a lie about someone else. He's fabricating a lie about the Prophet. Let the one who fabricates a lie about me deliberately prepare himself for his place in hellfire. Such as the one who might say, "The Prophet said such and such," while knowing that the Prophet didn't say it. And some people fabricate lies about the Prophet, but that fabrication will reach the level of blasphemy, wal'ayyazu billah. Like some people who say, "The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the one who gives people the news about the beginning of Rajab will never be tortured in hellfire." This is against the rules of the religion. So if, and the Arabs in the past, the non-believers, they used to observe these months. So they know now it's the beginning of the new month. So if an unbeliever says to another person, "The month of Rajab has started," that means he won't be tortured in hellfire. That's a fabrication. Others might say, wal'ayyazu billah, and we heard this from some ignorant people. They say, "The Prophet says to you, steal, commit fornication, commit adultery, but do not lie." What's this fabrication? They want to encourage people not to lie, but that's what they say. They fabricate something about the Prophet that reaches the level of blasphemy. So if it doesn't reach the level of blasphemy, it's a major sin. If it reaches the level of blasphemy, it becomes blasphemous. Same as for one to lie about Allah Azza wa Jal. It can be a major sin and it can be blasphemy. A person may say, "Allah gave me such and such," which Allah didn't give him. So he might be showing off in front of others, and he might say, "Allah gave me such and such." He's lying. He's lying about Allah Azza wa Jal, but that's a major sin. If he lies about Allah in a way that would reach blasphemy, will be blasphemous, such as to belie the rules of the religion. Our Shaykh mentioned to us that he was informed about a group of young people who were talking, laughing, and the like, hanging around with each other. Then a blind, poor person came and he was begging them. He wanted help, so he was begging them. One of those young ones wanted to joke around to make them laugh. He hit that blind person, he made him fall to the ground. And he said, wal'ayyazu billah, he said, "Allah Ta'ala said, when you see a blind man, hit him, let him fall to the ground. You are not more generous than his Lord." So he made that fabrication, but he's belying the rules of the religion in this matter. And that's why it is classified as blasphemous in that case. To swear at a Muslim unjustly, to curse him, to damn him, that is a major sin. Or to mock a Muslim or utter anything that would harm that Muslim. Sometimes even mimicking him would make that Muslim harmed. So you do not mimic the way he talks or the way he walks and the like to make fun of him, that is haram. And to make a false claim, that's amongst the sins of the tongue as well. And also amongst the sins of the tongue is to fall into bid'i divorce. Now, you know, if a person were to divorce his wife, if they reach a stage where they choose to leave each other and he wants to divorce her, there are certain times, if he were to divorce his wife within that period of time, he will be sinful. And that is called the bid'i divorce. The divorce that is haram. And that is when one divorces his wife when she is menstruating or in her postpartum bleeding period. Why this is haram? Because this will prolong her period. Because Islamically, the divorced lady has to wait 3 non-menstrual periods before her iddah, that's the waiting period, finishes. 3 non-menstrual periods, non-bleeding periods. So let us say if she was in a non-bleeding period, that's tuhur they call it, and he divorces her, this is counted. Then the first period she sees, that's the first menstruation. Then non-bleeding period, that's tuhur. Then another menstruation, that's the second. Then non-bleeding period. Then whenever she sees the blood after that, her adda has finished. As you can see. If he divorces his wife while she's menstruating, so she has to wait until she finishes this menstruation, then she starts counting the first non-bleeding period, then the bleeding period, then the non-bleeding period, then the bleeding period, then the non-bleeding period, then when she sees the blood after that, her adda will finish. So as you can see, the adda has prolonged because of this matter. So there is a harm inflicted upon her in such a case. That's why it's forbidden. Same if he divorces her when she is in her postpartum bleeding period. Imagine, let us say, after giving birth, he divorces her. Now, if she will see the blood for 40 days, that's the common. So then she starts counting 3 non-menstrual periods afterwards. So he prolonged the iddah, the waiting period for her. That's why that is haram. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu divorced his wife when she was in her menstruation period. Umar radiallahu anhu did not like this, so he came to the Prophet and told him about his son. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam guided him. He told him, order him to get her back. Then to wait until she finishes, then she will have the another bleeding period. Then when she finishes, will be in non-bleeding period, then it's up to him to keep her or to divorce her after that. He's teaching him when is the time to divorce one's wife. So as you can see, for one to be saved, he needs to learn even about these matters. Even about these matters. If one were to divorce his wife during a non-bleeding period, but after he had sexual intercourse with her, that is also haram. That is also haram. Although this non-bleeding period is counted as part of the iddah, but it is haram. Why? Because he might regret this divorce later. She might be pregnant, and then that could be the third divorce, or he might divorce her 3 times, so then the kids will be born away from their father. So he would regret. So this kind of divorce will be followed by regret usually. That's why it's forbidden as well. As you can see, like even in these matters, if one is not knowledgeable about them, he might fall into sins with or without realizing. That's why one needs to acquire the knowledge of the religion, especially this portion of the obligatory knowledge. And once he attains that portion of the obligatory knowledge, he would have a scale. He can weigh things properly. And he would realize that before I get engaged in anything in the future, I'll make sure to ask what is accepted and what is forbidden. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We say La ilaha illallah and make salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.